OK. Hello, everyone. We are going to start session soon. And so welcome to the most impact paper award session. So since 2016, IUI Organizing Committee recognized one paper each year that published more than 10 years ago at IUI, which has generated a significant impact to the IUI community. So this year, the 2019 IUI Most Impact Paper Award Committee has selected this paper, Supple, automatically generating user interfaces as the award recipient. The paper is by Christopher Gayers and Dan Will. And the committee recognized this is one of the best examples to represent the binocular view of IUI, which is AI, using AI approaches to help user interface design. And also, this is a very good example of one of the early framework, which is using general optimization to incorporate both the characteristics of the devices as well as the user interaction patterns into as constraints in the constrained optimization framework. So since, you know, this is one of the novel method when it was first proposed in 2004, but still very relevant to today. And since it was published in 2004, it has generated many impact to several IUI fields, including automated user interface generation, and also user interface adaptation for assistive technology, and also personalized UI design, as well as, you know, UI adaptation for mobile, pervasive, and ubiquitous computing. So without further ado, let's please join us to, you know, recognize this great accomplishment. So so Dan and Christopher, so it's our, you know, great pleasure to to present you the 2019 Most Impact Paper Award, and congratulations.
Thank you. I'm going to shake your hand. Handshake.
Sorry. So the organization of the session is like this. First, the authors will present the paper, and then we will have a panel which will discuss and reflect on the impact of this paper to the IUI community. And towards the end, we will open this to the audience to take questions, okay? So without further ado, let's the authors to have start their presentation.
Thank you. My name is Krzysztof. You will hear today from me and Dan Weld. But we would also like to acknowledge Jake Wabrock, who joined our project a little bit later, but had tremendous impact on the project overall. Our plan for today is to briefly give you a chronological reflection on where this project came from and what we actually did, because the paper was published 15 years ago. Probably only a small subset of you saw the original paper, and the original paper was only a fraction of the entire project. The project lasted for 6 years. And afterwards, both Dan and I will reflect on one idea that we believe we tried to influence, with which we tried to have an impact on intellectual impact on the community. So just to give you some idea of what the project was about, we've built a system that used decision theoretic optimization to automatically generate user interfaces. As you can see, we're able to build a system that very quickly solved a fairly complex optimization problem to automatically generate user interfaces adapted to different screen sizes, but also to different device types. What's important about SAPL is that it not only changes the layout, but it changes what kind of interactors are used to communicate different pieces of information. It changes the overall structure of the user interface as well as its layout. So it was a fairly complex set of, it was a very complex combinatorial problem to solve. To tell you where this project came from, we need to go back quite a few years into the past. Into the world where phones were used primarily for calling people, like hello Dan, where if you wanted to go to the airport not by public transportation, you had to wonder if the taxi will come and it would take 20 minutes or 40 minutes to come. So these were very different times. Lots of uncertainty. But there were three really big ideas that that influenced our thinking at the time. The first one was that people started documenting that our software kept getting more and more complex. Joanna McGranary published a paper in 2000 documenting this phenomenon and showing that most people used only a tiny fraction of the features available in their software, but everyone used slightly different tiny subset of the features. So really what happened was that each one of us wanted a device of roughly this level of complexity, but each one of us wanted a slightly different version of this device, and the manufacturer's response was something like this. So this is how it manifested itself in the world of software. And the problem was that each one of us could find features that we needed in this software, but because each one needed slightly different subset, often the features that we used a lot required a lot of effort to get to. One thing that particularly peeved Dan, and I remember it from my early meeting with him, was that he felt that printing required just way too much effort on his part. So Dan, being from Seattle and a nature lover, always printed duplex to save paper. And at that time, it required actually an unreasonable amount of effort. So first you click on properties, then you click on features. Hello. Then you select the kind of binding you want, and only then you have to click one OK, and then you have to click yet another OK. So this was a lot of work just to save the tree, but Dan persevered. But he described to me a future world in which maybe this wouldn't be so hard. A world in which instead the software could recognize that we all have slightly different ways of using the software, and maybe it could adapt itself to it. So notice here Dan envisioned a universe in which the content of the print dialog would be adapted to reflect the feature set that he used frequently. And not only that, he thought maybe we could design a universe in which not only the duplex would be duplicated here, but the system would recognize that he only ever used one version of the duplex, the book binding. So maybe rather than presenting a set of radio buttons, the system would present a checkbox instead. So this was the second influence. This was the first influence. The second influence was ubiquitous computing. So this was 10 years after Mark Weiser's very influential paper introducing the notion of ubiquitous computing, the world in which we've got tons and tons of interconnected devices, some the size of the room, some the size of something like this, some that we could put in our pockets, and we would want user interfaces running in all of these devices, potentially requiring that we adapt both the content and the presentation of the user interfaces. And finally, we recognized that accessible computing was another area where we really needed to think about adapting user interfaces to individuals. And to illustrate this is a gentleman with whom we worked at some point in our study. He has spastic cerebral palsy. What you see here is his chin. He's using his chin to control a trackball to control the mouse position, and he also had a head-mounted wand to tap on the keyboard. Another person that we worked with, this lady has muscular dystrophy, so severe muscle weakness. While the previous gentleman could make rapid movement, he had problems with dexterity and accuracy. This person could make very accurate movements, but had difficulty making large movements. So the way they interacted with user interfaces was that the first gentleman had really difficult time accessing small interactors like scrolling or pull-down menus, whereas the second person had a very hard time making large navigation movements. So what became very obvious to us is that there wasn't such thing as one universal design or one accessibility design, that every individual with impairments potentially needed a different solution because they had different sets of limitations and also different things that they could do well. So with these three motivations, we realized that we wanted a world in which user interfaces could adapt both content structure and presentation to the individual tasks and needs and preferences of their users. So we were, at the time, both of us were core AI guys, and we were super excited about symbolically manipulating abstract representation of the user interfaces, and we had fantastic plans for how we could transform the representations of these user interfaces to represent all of these different things. But there was this one annoyance that was left. Once we transformed these abstract representations of the UIs, somehow we had to turn them back into actual user interfaces. So we looked at various approaches to doing so. At that time, quite a few people took inspiration from compilers, so using those techniques to turn abstract representations of UIs to concrete user interfaces. Others took inspiration from rule-based expert systems where designers' knowledge was codified in rules and transformed, used that to generate user interfaces. We instead conceptualized design a little bit differently. So when you ask designers how they design, they describe the process in a couple of steps. First, they generate a large number of possible ideas to understand what the solution space is. And once they have a large number of candidate solutions, then they try to understand, okay, which one of these is better? How do I evaluate them? And then choosing the best from among this large set. So to us, it looked very much like optimization, right? So a process in which you first have to enumerate candidate solutions, then have some way of deciding which one of them is better than the others. And finally, you need a computational process where you can perform this selection quickly. So let me briefly tell you how we did it. So first, to enumerate the design space, as I mentioned, we are very excited about abstractly representing user interfaces. So we represented them as trees where the leaf nodes corresponded to the different types of information that needed to be exchanged between the application and the user, and the interior nodes corresponded to semantic groupings of these elements. And what we wanted was a system that would transform this abstract representation into a concrete user interface, turning the leaves into specific interactors and the interior nodes into layout decisions. Next, to evaluate the candidate solutions. Now, this is where things started getting complicated, because we needed some computational mechanism that given two user interfaces, would tell us that one of them was better than the other. So we needed some function that would take a user interface or a fraction of the user interface and say this design decision is better than the other. So we thought about it in terms of cost. So worse design solution should have higher cost than a better design solution. Now, where should such cost functions come from? In 2004, when we published this paper, the cost function came from my head. I essentially handcrafted it, 50 different numerical parameters. I managed to find the right selection of these numbers so that Supple would generate pretty good solutions. But this wasn't particularly satisfying, so in the following years, we came up with two more approaches. One, would learn the cost function by asking an expert you know, how should I design, and using machine learning to infer the weights of the cost function. And the second was, and this was inspired by our accessibility work, to learn the actual performance of individuals that we worked with. The cost function would predict how long a person would take to complete a basic set of tasks with a particular user design. So let me go into just a little bit more detail with this. So when we designed the cost function that learned from experts, the interaction model was based on the idea that rather than rating the quality of the user interfaces, we would present experts with pairs of designs, and each time we would ask which of these designs is better. So the experts only had to perform pairwise comparisons, which turned out to be a more robust technique for eliciting reliable feedback from experts. And this turned out to be an effective thing once we paired it with an appropriate learning algorithm. In just 20 interactions, we could get high-quality designs. So the system was within just 20 or 30 interactions with an expert was able to learn a cost function that really reflected that expert's knowledge reasonably well. And by providing different answers to the algorithm, we could teach the algorithm to design very different kinds of user interfaces. So on the left, you see an interface designed for a laptop. On the right, you see an interface designed for a touch screen. And the reason why SAPL was generating these different interfaces was because the experts told it a different set of design principles. The second approach that we took to creating cost functions was to learn the actual performance of individuals, particularly individuals with user impairments. So because most of our work in context of SAPL was focused on people with motor impairments, we specifically focused on how quickly people could perform a set of activities with a user interface, because the speed of performance was the major limiting factor. So we created a set of diagnostic tasks. We created a way of learning appropriate function. It turned out that Fitzla was not sufficient for people with complex impairments, so we created our own models that could predict people's actual performance. And you know, for the people that we showed you before, given this user interface designed for able-bodied people, this was the version designed for a person with spastic cerebral palsy, so somebody who had low dexterity. This is a design for somebody with muscle weakness. You might notice that the previous design still had the tabs at the top, so you still had to make large movements, but all of the interactors were large. Here, everything is tightly laid out in a single pane, no need to switch panes. And very importantly, we didn't tell SAPL these are the rules for designing for these people. SAPL inferred it by having a model of a person's performance and model of what they were supposed to accomplish, and finding a design that was predicted to be the fastest for that person. So the last challenge was that we needed to, that once we had the candidate solutions, we needed to find the best one quickly. And this was challenging because for some of the designs, there were, you know, 10 to the 17 different possible solutions. So how do we search through such a large design space? If we did it naively, you know, I would have tenure as a graduate student. I could, you know, stay till I retired. So we're looking for something a little bit more efficient. So we, using state-of-the-art discrete optimization algorithms with some clever constraint propagation and some parallelization, we're able to make it really interactive. So you've already seen this video, but now you can appreciate it. You know, searching through a space of 10 to 17 different solutions, we're able to do it in a fraction of a second. This is rendering in real time on a machine that is, you know, more than 10 years old. And trivially, we were able to generate user interfaces for very different devices simply by swapping the libraries of available widgets and by swapping the cost functions. And SAPL was able to generate user interfaces for fairly complex user interfaces, like mail clients, for, you know, in high interactivity interfaces. And I'm pleased to say that I was able to solve Dan's printing problem. We actually had several solutions for this, but one solution was to allow end-user customization. So notice that over here, a person can simply just drag part of the user interface, drop it in another person, in another place, and get a user interface that reflects this modification. And this is possible because the presentation of the UI was linked bidirectionally with the abstract representation. So when the modification was being made in the concrete user interface, the underlying tree was being modified, and we could very easily re-render this user interface. So this bidirectional connection between the representation, abstract representation, and the UI allowed us to do pretty large modifications. And let me illustrate this point one more time with another user interface. So this is Microsoft Ribbon. So this is perhaps one of the first examples of responsive UIs. You will notice that as the window gets narrower or wider, the presentation of the ribbon changes. Things get hidden into pop-up menus. Some of the text disappears. So you know, with Supple, we could very easily reproduce this effect. But very importantly, while original ribbon, and I think even today's ribbon, makes it incredibly hard to modify the content of the ribbon, because with today's technique for responsive design, the designer kind of needs to know the content of the UI and make assumptions about the final device when they are designing the logic for the responsive behavior. With Supple, we could even modify the content. So what's happening here is that we created a new group. We are copying some functionality into this group. So we are on the fly changing the content of the ribbon. And despite the fact that the designer never saw this new design of the user interface, as we resize the screen, the Supple ribbon adapts correctly. Okay. Let's see if HDMI disappeared. Okay, we're here. So another thing with Supple is that it was very easy to, through constraints and modifying the objective function, it was very easy to incorporate many different concerns into the design. So this is a design for a typical able-bodied person. By changing the cost function, we could very easily design for a person with impaired dexterity by using larger interactors. We could also very easily design for a person with impaired vision by constraining the sizes of the visual cues. But also, very importantly, we could combine both of these adaptations to design something for a person with both low dexterity and low vision, which is something that today's adaptive techniques still are not able to do. Most adaptive techniques are single disability only. So, just to remind you of this previous result, we conducted a study with over a dozen people with very different motor impairments, and with Supple we were able to build a unique model for each of these people, a unique model of their abilities. We were able to generate unique user interface for that person, and in our summative evaluation, when we evaluated people's performance on the standard user interfaces, people with impairments were on average twice as slow as able-bodied people performing standard tasks on standard user interfaces. However, with Supple-generated user interfaces, which were optimized for each individual separately, we were able to close more than half of this performance gap. And this brings me to the impact of our work. So Dan and I will present one idea each. And to me, one of the most personally impactful ideas from Supple was something that with some colleagues we called personalized dynamic accessibility, and with others, ability-based design. But the key principle was that while public discourse about accessibility even today is still mostly about the possibility of access, we are asking, can this person access a particular digital resource, yes or no? We realize that it's not really about the possibility of access, it is about the quality of access. We want to make sure that the access is equitable. And let me explain it through several concepts and examples. So first, the World Health Organization definition of disability. So World Health Organization says that disability is a limitation one experiences when executing a task or an action. So if I have trouble, you know, picking up a pen, I am experiencing a disability. However, handicap is when, you know, my particular health condition or difference impacts my ability to be involved in life situations, so my ability to participate socially. So notice that this effect that we accomplished over here is very important for eliminating handicap and not just disability. This person, I didn't tell you that before, but he actually has a degree in computer science and he runs his own business, his own IT consultancy. However, despite the fact that he's got an incredibly marketable set of skills, he lives in a trailer park because he's three times slower than his able-bodied counterparts at performing basic tasks with the computers. Therefore, he can accept fewer clients, therefore he has lower income. So if he had user interfaces that were better adapted to what he could do, he would be able to perform his activities much faster and therefore he would have a much more comfortable life. This person was an undergraduate student at the University of Washington. And she experienced the following dilemma. She could access all of the software that was required in her courses, but if she took full load of courses, she was much slower operating the software, so she couldn't finish all of her assignments, so her grades suffered. If she took fewer courses per semester, then her financial aid would run out before she got her degree. So in either way, she was not able to prepare herself professionally for her career, not because she couldn't access the software required in her classes, but she couldn't require it as well as everybody else. Another example of, to illustrate the concept of equitable design, this is Memorial Church at Harvard. If you want to enter it and you're in a wheelchair, here you see the sign directing it to the side, and then there is this ramp that takes you to the basement entrance. And then, you know, you have to navigate through the basement to the elevator, and eventually you get up through the back door. Imagine if you were being married here, and if you were in a wheelchair, entering church, you know, for your own wedding on a, you know, through the basement, or even for somebody else's wedding, or in any other situation. So this solution is sufficient to reduce the disability, right? This person can enter the church. However, they are not being socially included in this experience. And I was delighted to see that in very recent renovation of Memorial Church, we now have this ramp on the side. Rather than going to the basement, there's this really aesthetically pleasing ramp. So it's a person with a mobility impairment can come up like everybody else, enter through the main door, not be separated socially from others. So this is something we are striving for. So this is the key principle of that we've been working with. And the second, of course, given our technical mindset, is that we believe that it is not the responsibility of a person with a difficulty to adapt themselves to existing technologies, but the technology has to adapt itself to the individuals who do not conform with the majority standards. So one other project in which we worked with this concept was a project in which we tried to adapt web content to individuals with color vision deficiencies. And again, we're striving not just for passability of access, but also for quality of access. So let me illustrate. So here is a website that through color communicates a lot of emotional content. You look at this red luscious lips, you get it, unless you've got a color vision deficiency. But notice that some of the content of this website is color coded. You've got these alternating links in red and green. So for a person with a color vision deficiency, this color encoded information is essentially gone. Existing recoloring tools that will try to find a different set of colors that a person can perceive focus on decoding the color encoded information, but entirely ignore the quality of experience. Like, this is not red luscious lips. This is like, I don't know, Arctic kiss of death. So our hope was to develop a system that would both preserve the color-encoded information and preserve as much of the emotional content of the color scheme as possible for people with color vision deficiencies. So the recoloring problem, you have to recolor each image separately because you have to work very carefully with just the subset of colors that this image uses. And so you take an image, you take a model of a particular individual's color perception, and you create a personalized mapping from colors in this image to the colors that the person can see. You won't be surprised that this problem is often thought of as an objective, as an optimization, problem. And when we approached it, we added new elements to this objective function that preserved both naturalness and similarity to the original emotional intent of the designer. We did some studies to actually understand how people with color vision deficiencies perceive emotional content of colors, and it turned out that it was quite comparable to people with regular color vision. And we developed a system that, given an original design, like this is what a person with color vision deficiencies would see. The color information is gone. Standard recolors would not respect the kind of emotional intent, and our system recovered both the color encoded information and the emotional content. So this idea of equitable design, so for quite a few years I focused primarily on accessibility, but I realized that this concept is actually much broader than that, and several individuals helped me get there. So one of them was Margaret Burnett. And Simone, one of our panelists, contributed to this work. Margaret has worked for a long time systematically gathering evidence showing that in our standard one-size-fits-all design, we often make decisions that slightly privilege men over women. When we design debuggers, when we design color schemes, when we design features, we often do it in such a way that men are just a little happier, a little bit more likely to succeed than women. There are systematic differences among individuals, and often, who gets to make these decisions influences, who gets to succeed with our software. So Margaret pointed out to some set of differences. Another one was my colleague Katharina Reinecke, who was very interested in cultural anthropology and design, and she pointed out a number of culture-related differences in perception, cognition, and behavior that also impact how accessible and usable software is to people coming from different cultures. And finally, Indrani Medhi from Microsoft Research India has done a lot of work documenting the impact of access to formal education and how people are able to deal with abstractions and both the content and the presentation of modern Western user interfaces. So I would like to focus on the one project that Katharina led, that is quite illustrative of the concepts that I'm talking about. So pay attention to the screen. You will see one design for just half a second. Okay, and now you will see another design also for just half a second. Okay, given these two designs, how many of you would be more likely to make a purchase from a site that looked like the first one? How many of you would be more likely to make a purchase from the site that looked like the second one? Okay, so which choice you made doesn't matter, but the fact that you confidently made this choice after seeing both sites for only half a second is very important, because you saw very little about the semantics and content of these sites, but you created a lasting impression that not only told you that to you one of these was more aesthetically pleasing than the other, but you also took it further. It turned into a perception of trustworthiness, your willingness to engage with a site, and also something that you don't realize: sites that are more aesthetically pleasing, UIs that are more aesthetically pleasing, are actually more usable. We are less likely to make errors, and when we do make errors, we are more likely to recover from them if a site is designed as aesthetically pleasing to us or not. So Katharina wanted to understand whether aesthetic appeal was universal or whether it was actually substantially differing from person to person, because if there were substantial differences, it would mean that, again, one-size-fits-all aesthetic design might possibly discriminate. So first we built Lab in the Wild. So it's a platform for conducting behavioral research with unpaid online volunteers. By now we've had more than 4 million participants. It's a really great way to do research. Join us if you want to. And one set of results was that looking at different levels of colorfulness, people from Germany, if you gave them too many colors, they started getting upset. People from Chile, we couldn't generate enough colors. the optimum level of colorfulness decreases the more exposure we have to formal education, even after controlling for age. And notice what that means. Like, look, for example, at the design of the edX site. So this site was, the mission of this site is to provide education to people who, you know, in faraway places who do not have access to formal education. But the design choices have been optimized for Westerners who already have access to who already have had a lot of exposure to formal education. When we look at these designs were preferred by women much more than by men, these designs were preferred by men much more than women, you will notice that these designs are both for resources for programmers. So again, you know, when we design tools for programmers, we tend to optimize a little bit more for male aesthetics than for female aesthetics, with the consequence being that we make women just a little bit less likely to engage and a little bit less likely to succeed with these tools. So essentially, thanks to Katarina, I realized that that there is a broad range in which we design in such a way that without meaning to, we end up systematically discriminating against some of the people. So I want to leave you with these two messages and hand it over to Dan, who will speak about the second set of concepts that we believe are impactful about this work.
And I need the microphone. So first of all, thank you very much to the organizers for the award. It really means a huge amount to me, and the SUPL work is work I'm incredibly pleased with. It's also been an opportunity to take a step back and think about impact and what makes for impactful work, which is kind of tricky. So I mean, some things are kind of obvious. Choose an important problem. You know, having the luck or the insight to choose the right approach to solve that problem, in this case, decision theoretic optimization. The luck that we happen to be one of the first people to recognize this and try to push it out. On the other hand, when I'm writing a paper, every paper I write, I sort of think is gonna be like this, and here we were a little bit lucky. I have a very strong memory. You know, as we wrote the SUPL paper, going to Ben Schneiderman, one of the grand old men in HCI, and trying to get him excited about the idea, he didn't like the idea at all. And so actually, I think we have an awful lot to thank him for this, because it was this challenge that really caused us to push on things a little bit harder. So in particular, one thing about impact is having the conviction to persevere on the project, and SUPL actually, if we had left it with the IUI paper, I don't think it would have had nearly as much impact, and instead we actually had to do a lot of extra work before we really demonstrated some of the promise. And of course, in that is a lot of great collaborators who helped us, especially Jake Wobrock. Another thing, just sort of thinking about impactful papers, there's this wonderful and very, very thought-provoking paper that came out in Nature a month ago that talks about disruptive papers versus developing papers and analyzes the citation graph for these two different kinds. Strongly recommend you think about this paper. It's pretty interesting, but I think the key thing is, if every paper was like aiming for a disruptive idea, then it wouldn't be any good. It takes a lot of developing papers in order to make an idea take shape and show its promise. In one way, I actually am sad that SUPL hasn't had nearly as much impact as I wish it would have. And I think we need to figure out some way of getting SUPL-like tools into the user UI design kits, so that people can very easily create these kinds of higher level semantic representations like Christoph showed in terms of the functional tree representation of the UI, so we can actually do that. On the other hand, actually, AI and some of the techniques that SUPL put forward is having a lot of impact. If you look at most of the software out there, AI is getting in one shape or another. And in particular, the idea of this decision theoretic optimization is getting a fair amount of play. And one example in crowdsourcing. So there's a lot of work, some of which my group did, that shows that if you optimize crowdsource workflows, you can actually get higher quality results with much, much less labor. In this case, a system by Jonathan Bragg used 87% less labor than a system that we had designed ourselves the year before and we thought was pretty good at the time. Another way to think about Supple is trying to put it in the context of the time, and the whole idea of adaptivity and user interfaces I think was pretty confusing back in 2004. So on the one hand, we had this beautiful paper by Eric Horvitz that lays out principles of mixed initiative user interface is still one of my favorite papers today. At the same time, we also had Clippy had just come out, violating all of those principles and gathering a huge amount of wrath. There was also, we just had this big debate about whether software agents were the right metaphor, or whether direct manipulation was the right thing, and I think direct manipulation came out looking a lot better in that exchange. And there are obviously lots of papers that preceded our work, and they led a very confusing confusing message about whether adaptivity was a good thing or a bad thing or just a mixed bag. So one of the things I think we've made a fair amount of progress in the past 20 years is trying to figure out what are the principles that should be used when trying to put adaptivity into interfaces. One of them is some work that Christoph and I did with Mary Chorwinski and Desni Tan in AVI06. And we looked at a couple different ways that we could, if we're tracking what kinds of behaviors a user is doing in the interface, how could we make it easier for them to do it? So Christoph gave one example with the print dialogue, which was one of my frustrations. But we looked at a number of different models. So one model is altering the salience of the interface, so just trying to take what you think the user is about to do and make it, in this case, color-coded or possibly larger. Another thing that people were trying at the time, which seemed quite problematic, is moving things around in the interface and hiding elements that were unlikely to be used from drop-down menus. So here's an example of some functionality moving around in the interface. And an approach that we were very excited about, and you could see in some of Christoph's examples, is this idea of a split interface, where one part of the interface stays very static, allowing a stable navigation where you can get access to all functionality, and then there's one part of the interface which is very dynamic and offers shortcuts. The AVI paper has a nice study that shows that this split interface idea is surprisingly good, and interestingly, the visual pop-out, the altered salience, users really didn't like that. Another piece of work I'd like to point people to is a paper coming out at CHI very shortly. This is a project led by Salima Amershi and a large group at Microsoft when I was there on sabbatical last year. And what we did is go through a wide range of papers that have been published over the past 20 years and try to pull them together into a set of guidelines and then analyze existing software systems across the board in many, many different areas to see how these principles were being applied. And in particular, we try to group these principles into whether or not they're sort of how to guide the initial interaction with users, what to do during interaction, what to do when the AI system makes a mistake or is uncertain of its prediction, and what to do over the course of time. The principles in many cases are going to seem like common sense to you, but I'd like to give a couple examples. So one thing is to make sure that the system, that the human knows if AI is involved and it's not going to get it right all the time, to give them expectations about what kind of a job it's going to do. So here's an example of Microsoft Office's companion experience, which docks alongside your work and gives you suggestions, one-click assistance for grammar, design, data insights, and so on. And the way this is described to the user, in this case, it's called Ideas, and the use of the word preview gives you a sense that maybe it's not going to always be right. So it helps set the user expectation. During interaction, I think there's a lot of important properties, many of which were elucidated in Eric Horvitz's early paper. One I'll talk a little bit on, though, is how to manage to match socially relevant norms. So here, again, we've got the editor, which is making suggestions, and it's using a very polite language to indicate the way it wants to interact with the user. Obviously, AI systems get things wrong from time to time, and so allowing the user to dismiss the interface or correct it is very, very important. In this case, it's an example of how Microsoft uses cloud services to automatically generate alt text for images, and by popping it up here, it invites the user to make edits if the system doesn't get it quite right. And then over time, there's quite a number of principles. One that I think is really important is providing global controls where the user can provide feedback about what kind of assistance they want for the UI. So as Microsoft's Office Editor allows more than just spelling and grammar checks, it allows quite a bit, and it has a control panel that lets you set exactly what the user would like the system to do. One other example I'd like to highlight is the importance of notifying users about changes in the AI. And this is actually followed up on an interesting paper by my graduate student Gagan Bansal based on some work that he did at Microsoft during an internship last summer. Paper appears at AAAI last month. And the observation is that oftentimes AI and a human are working together in a team, and the key thing to do is to make sure that the team itself has the highest performance. But oftentimes, AI researchers focus much more on the performance of the AI system. And the key thing is with machine learning, oftentimes, when you update a machine learning system, training on more examples, for example, for more data, for example, you can really improve the accuracy of the machine learning system, and that's what AI people like to focus on. But what oftentimes happens is you get very low compatibility. So the places where the AI system makes mistakes change dramatically on an update. And this can be very confusing to users because users, just as we develop mental models of other people that we collaborate with, users develop mental models of the AI system and where they make mistakes, as this paper shows. Here we've got an AI system which has a certain amount of performance, and hopefully the human and the AI working together have a higher performance. When you update the AI system, giving it a higher performance, you're hoping that the team is going to do better, but oftentimes, as Gagan shows, the team actually does much worse. And so a key thing to do, as the paper goes into some detail about, is to regularize based on previous performance to make sure that the system doesn't change its behavior too much, as well as notifying the user when those updates happen. So in summary, here are some of the things we've learned in the past 15 years, and I strongly encourage people to check out this paper. I really think it's quite nice. With that, let me thank you again and switch things over to the panel.
Yeah. Yeah. My name is Henry Lieberman. I'm a research scientist at the MIT Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Lab, and I was twice program chair of IUI, and I write the blog for TEAS, for the Transactions on Intelligent Interactive Systems.
Hi, my name is Simone Stumpf. I'm from City University of London. My background is mainly in HCI with a bit of AI thrown in. I have been very active in explainable AI. I'm doing lots of other stuff in terms of personal information systems as well. So I think I'm a bit of the jackknife that Christoph told.
I have my own mic. my name is Jeff Nichols. I was a PhD student at exactly the same time as this work was going on, also doing work in automatic interface generation. But now I am a research scientist at Google. I work primarily on a new operating system, building a UI framework for that, but we are also thinking a little bit about some of these ideas. Maybe they'll get out sometime soon. We'll see.
Okay, thank you. First, I would like to ask the panelists to reflect a little bit about the paper's impact based on their own experience. Simone, can start a little?
I'm going first. When I was asked to join the panel and reflect a little bit on the paper, I actually hadn't read it probably since 2004, 2005, just after it came out. But about a week before this, I read it again. And what struck me is that it was a really nice paper. It was sort of one of those model papers where you go, I have a question. And then the next paragraph, the question is answered. So it was really nice academic work that a lot of people from different backgrounds can actually read, and it's approachable, and it's really clearly written. So if you think about writing an IUI paper, this is one of the sort of models of how to do it. So I thought that was really, really great stuff. And then I started thinking about, okay, well, what has actually happened since then? Because it's such a neat idea. And I think, as the authors already have pointed out, we're still with responsive design, right? A designer would take a sort of interface design and just adjust it for different displays and display sizes and make some decisions based on that. So I think, we might want to sort of explore a little bit why, we're still at that stage rather than having, adaptive interfaces being generated right now for all of the sort of software. And then I think, lastly, one of the things I was thinking about is, well, what is the future? Where can we apply it? And I think, and this sort of ties my thoughts and this panel and this presentation back to the keynote this morning. So I work in explainable AI. A lot of you saw the presentation by Dave Gunning this morning about, this is the stuff that has been happening. And then, as I was rereading the paper, I was starting to think, well, what if we treat explainable AI as an optimization problem, right? So rather than optimizing for different displays, why don't we optimize explanations for different users? So again, making them accessible to all. You might have different presentation mechanisms, you might have different kinds of contents. And that really sort of excited me, the possibility of using the same approach in completely different domains. So I think it shows that this paper really had a lot of impact, perhaps not immediately in industry, but definitely on the knowledge that we're taking from it.
I'll go next, I guess. So I think, you know, I was also really interested in that question of, you know, what would it take for this work, you know, to really become that real gangbusters thing, you know, in industry takes over and everyone's, you know, able to benefit from automatically generated interfaces. And I think one of the reasons we really want that to happen is because it unlocks all this flexibility in our user interfaces, not just with the accessibility stuff, which Christoph showed, which obviously would be incredibly impactful, but just in terms of personalization, like, can my interfaces, you know, can the new interfaces that I see be designed to look like things that I've seen in the past so that I can just, you know, have a, you know, build on my experience in order to, you know, be able to use my interfaces more effectively. You know, if I'm using multiple things together, can I just integrate these all into one user interface instead of having to flip back and forth between different apps that I'm using, you know, and just generally have to do a lot of my own work coordinating my interfaces. It would be nice if the system could just do that for me. And I think one of the reasons that this hasn't happened yet goes back to actually the description of the user interface. What I called my work the specification language. I think Christoph talked about it as kind of the formal description of the user interface. You know, that I think there are two real big problems when we look at interface generation. One, I think, you know, with the optimization work Christoph showed, given that you have the formal description, we can generate really great interfaces. But we have to get these formal descriptions written and tied into the code that actually operates the user interface. And that's a whole other, you know, really big challenge that I think hasn't been addressed quite as well yet. And it would be really great, in fact, to see all of you wonderful, you know, IUI researchers out there maybe think a little bit about that. Maybe we can close that gap and really, you know, see this work have even greater impact than it's had so far.
Yeah, so I think this was a really great paper. It was certainly, you know, a flawless model of how to write an IUI paper. But I think what really makes a great impact paper is that it continues to inspire. That even looked at from a 2019 perspective, there's a lot in it that really should inspire the work of all of us for the future. And I think one thing that struck me as I listened to Christoph and Dan's presentation was mobile interfaces. We still have a really lot of work to do with mobile interfaces. And the CIDE community, they spent a long time making principles for good design of user interfaces, user interface affordances and stuff. And then when smartphones came in, all that got thrown out the window. The interfaces are terrible. They don't have affordances. They have disappearing stuff. They have invisible features, you know. From the standpoint of traditional interface design, a lot of these interfaces are really bad, but I think people were so caught up in the thing, wow, I've got a computer in my pocket, you know, that they were able to forgive it. And the Kai people dropped the ball. They didn't want to rain on the party, okay? But we've had smartphones for a while now, and I think we need to really think about improving the interfaces that we have. So, you know, it might be that user interface adaptation is a little disruptive, but, you know, I wake up in the morning and suddenly, you know, some application I'm using has an entirely new interface because they downloaded it from the cloud when I was asleep, you know, and they weren't paying attention to my usage or to anything. So I think, and some of the lessons, some of the inspiring features that we saw, like being able to put up a dialog box and say, I'd like that to be more convenient, so I'll just drag that into the default dialog box. And I think those kinds of things are just great inspirations for where we could go with interfaces in the future. Using machine, now we have a lot of machine learning stuff, it's a lot better. So it could do a lot better in using the trace of your actual usage and the usage of other people to improve the interface. So just sitting here listening to it, I was inspired in at least 10 different ways, and so that's why we chose this paper as an impact paper.
Thank you. And in the author's presentation, as well as the initial panel's feedback, and we already addressed some of the issues in terms of this is a very nice framework, and also the impact. Paper has a larger number of citations, but mostly are from the research community. So they already said a little bit about how to make it even more easily to be adopted in the real world. So any more comments on how to, what are the things we can do as a community to make it more easily adopted in the real world? Any more comments on that?
I think beyond the specification language stuff that I talked about, I think there's, a whole, related to that, I think there's a whole area of work in kind of in terms of outreach to designers, like, how, supposing that a designer is designing an interface that they know is going to be generated, that the final version of it's going to be generated and it's going to look different in different contexts, how does a designer understand that? How do they, is the design process even the same when you're working that way? I don't know. So I think there's a lot of work to do there to kind of, engage the design community and not just keep it among ourselves as computer scientists.
Speaking as a former UX designer before I went into academia, obviously, using adaptive interfaces that are essentially trained by the user has the potential to do away with most of the UX designers, right? Where they actually just become, the sort of trainers to set the sort of empty trace kind of default position. You have a bit of work to do to kind of position it, because essentially then the job becomes very, very different, right? As Jeff said, reaching out to some of these communities and actually saying, these are the benefits of doing that, here's how you would integrate it into your work, and that doesn't mean that, your design knowledge gets wasted, because we still need you. I think that is also important to consider.
Yeah. I think we need a class action lawsuit, to be honest. I think the designers oftentimes go out of their way to make things non-adaptive. We see that in HTML, which was beautifully designed to be adaptive, and all sorts of UI designers instead put these fixed width windows in there that just won't let me scale up for my bad vision. So class action lawsuit, that's my vote.
I may go against the grain here. I grew up as an AI researcher, now I align myself with human-computer interaction, because at some point Tessalau, a prominent member of our community, made me realize that as members of the IUI community, our ultimate goal and our ultimate criterion of success is whether or not we make a positive difference in somebody's life. Even if we are mostly focused on the AI, we evaluate the value of our work on the impact in the real world. So I teach an HCI course, and the first thing that I say in the first class is that there is no such thing as user error. There's no such thing as a designer doing making wrong choices. If somebody is making an error, it means that we, as designers of the tools, have failed to understand their practices, their needs, and their values. So I think it's on us to really understand how designers work, what helps them ideate, and how we can integrate, these wonderful ideas into workflows that make sense for designers. There was a wonderful paper about 10 years ago titled GAMI that showed how we can recover a functional specification, an abstract functional specification of a user interface by observing how a designer is designing subsequent versions of a concrete user interface. So as designers ideate on concrete ideas, we can automatically recover the abstract representation. And so The reason why this work is not having an impact is because we have not given designers tools with which they can that would reduce the overhead of creating the functional specification. And also, you know, Dan was speaking about the importance of creating AI in such a way that is respectful and give users a sense of control and predictability of what's going on. We have not given that to the designers with SAPL. They really do not know what's going to happen, but we could give them much more understanding and much more control so that they would feel much more confident that the designs that SAPL will create will not embarrass them.
While I'm going to join Dan's class action lawsuit as a co-plaintiff, I think I might also join Simone's future class action lawsuit against AI researchers for a violation of aesthetic rules. I think that you know, we have to have kind of the ambition of the initial work, I think, was not to make a statement about aesthetics or to try to automatically design making designs that obey some aesthetic rules, but I think that's not the end of the story. So I think designers might see their role differently as, you know, combining aesthetics and functionality, but I don't think you know, you can have functional and ugly interfaces, and I don't think that's what people want either.
So I too was struck by a number of the user interfaces that Christoph presented for people with physical disabilities. I thought they were really pretty ugly. We probably all noticed that. But what I thought was really interesting truth is that beauty's in the eye of the beholder. So one question that we included in the user study that Christoph didn't report on was how pretty do you think this interface is compared to the standard one? And the people with disabilities thought that their interface was, that the SAPL generated interface was much more attractive. So it's a little bit more complicated than one might think.
Okay, any final thought on, you know, what might be the main future directions for this line of work? Anybody want to comment on that?
So I have two, I guess, real quick. I think one, obviously there's a lot more conversational interfaces today than there were back in 2004. So thinking about how this work applies to that conversational space, maybe in optimizing grammars in some way. Could be interesting. I think another area is in thinking about how to apply, you know, data about user interfaces to this process. You know, as Christoph was saying, you know, a lot of, especially early on, you know, you came up with the parameters yourself. But it's not just the parameters, right? Like also, you know, there are only certain types of layouts that you could do because it was like either it's vertical from it or horizontal. You know, and thinking about, you know, can we collect a lot of data about user interfaces and try to learn something from that and then apply it to, you know, figuring out how to make an interface more aesthetic, for example, or something like that. It could be interesting to try.
So I think what excites me in this work is, and I think that was hinted at, is sort of making things accessible to all, and that means really individualizing to the users. And I think that is really a powerful direction of how we can do that, not just for impairments, but also for other individual differences, for example, gender or different styles of thinking, different needs that we have in terms of the user interface. And so I think that is a really powerful thing to go forward with.
Okay, that's conclude the panel, but you know, now we open to the audience. Any questions for the...
Congratulations again, Dan and Christoph. So actually, as I said to Simon, I haven't read this paper for a long time. And today, actually, I just watched Christopher present the paper, and I say, oh, gee, that's really neat. How can the current interface actually doesn't do a lot of things he just showed, right? So then I look at your another website, this beautiful website you did for the, it's called the World Lab? Lab in the Wild, right? So I'm just wondering whether you can combine the two kind of like ideas together, because you, and I also wholeheartedly agree with you, it is that you want your work to really impact people's life in the real world. So I recently have gone through this horrible experience, it is, because I didn't know anything about HTML, but we have to make a website for our company, and my designer just quit. So I said, I have to do it. I have to learn the Bootstrap, right? Bootstrap, nice thing about it, is responsive interfaces. So you have the different devices, so there's different resolution, with different screen resolutions. I'm wondering, how do you see the work you did in SAPO can be actually applied to web design, maybe coupled with what Jeff said, the last suggestion of the future work. Can we use your work in SAPO, but the constraints might be changed, the cost function might be changed, right? But actually to design adaptive websites. For example, in my case, the people come in, I knew there are probably about 5-6 categories of people come in. They're looking for completely different things. I don't have time. I don't have that experience even, designer experience, to design adaptive websites for my potential visitors. And also, it have to look beautiful as well.
So I think your key question was how do we use SAPO like ideas to make them actually work on the web. So
yeah, don't need to worry about Microsoft, don't need to worry about, I don't know how many people are developing operating system right now. I know how hard it is to take that influence them. I'm just wondering, can you use it for really millions of people, right? Millions of people probably design websites.
So I think we could actually implement some of SAPO like ideas into a modern toolkit. I think it's just a SMOP, a small model of programming. and I don't think full SAPL-like solution would be quite feasible or quite appropriate for today's web, but I think there are some things that we ought to be trying. So for example, you know, we have some accessibility features built into the websites. You can often go to the top right corner and click on a large A, and you know the website gets redesigned to have larger visual cues. We do not have the same thing for people with dexterity impairments, for example. So you know, one of the huge impairments to people with dexterity difficulties is that when we have pull down menus, you have to perform several accurate clicks before you succeed. And if your probability of an error is 20% at each click, then essentially it becomes more and more impossible for you to complete the selection accurately when you have cascading menus. So, you know, we want to create adaptivity, either user-driven or automatic, that would not only change the layout or what's visible, but also, you know, would reason about what interactors we are using, or, you know, perhaps even about the content. I think some of it is within reach, and we could do with, you know, moderate engineering effort. And I think we could do it in such a way that people would still have a sense of control. If I only had the right graduate student.
More questions?
I have a wish list. And inspired by Christopher's work and say, I teach and I use whiteboard a lot to write what I want to tell to my students. And very often, my handwriting could not be good enough to be read by students. In other words, my handwriting sucks. I can't talk good. And my students need to be more improved by my handwriting. And I might wish this right here. You know, your technique could help people like me to have the good handwriting when they talk and write it in the right whiteboard or smartboard.
All right.
Well, I think that does, what that makes me think of at least is, you know, one of the possible solutions to the specification language problem we were talking about is, you know, to have people like sketch out a UI and then figure out what the specification from that is, and then that would get us to the optimization approach then we can apply from Christoph. I think that would be awesome. I think that's another great research project for someone to do.
Hi, Fabio Paterno from CNR. I mean, nowadays, I mean, there are many adaptive user interfaces. I mean, there's a responsive design. There are, you know, user interface, they change the content depending on what people like and so on. I mean, and they don't use the SAPL approach. So the question is, I mean, don't you think that maybe this idea to have a single cost function that is able to predict the best solution is a little bit too ambitious to be deployed in real cases, because it seems like, you know, where reality is moving is more towards solution where there are, you know, many rules, there can be conflict, but I mean, there is not really this concept of a cost function that automatically, oh, this is the best, they'll go that way.
I think you're right that it would be hard to come up with a, you know, one generic cost function to rule them all. But I think the real problem right now, though, is that you're right that there are a lot of adaptive interfaces, but they're all created as one-offs, and as a result, not only are they, I mean, it's nice that they're there and that they've been created, but they're also a little inconsistent with each other. Sometimes they may be. Maybe that's appropriate for the domain. I think in other cases it's not. I sit down in front of one tool and I'm like, oh, it adapted that way. I sit down in front of something else and it's like, what did it just do? I don't understand. And so I do think it would be great if we could have a framework in which we could implement those cost functions. Maybe we do different things in different domains, but you know, I don't think the current situation today is great.
One thing that dimension that I think is not appreciated enough in interface design is the difference between high functionality and low functionality interfaces. So when the interface, you know, like the difference between Apple's Preview on the Mac, which is an image editor, but it has can't really do very much, and then Photoshop, okay. And I think a lot of the interface problems we get from trying to use the methodology of low functionality interfaces to then design high functionality interfaces. And I think that's where things screw up. So, you know, if you have just a few operations, yes, you can lay them out on static menus and they don't have to change, and that's fantastic. But with high functionality interfaces like Microsoft Word or Photoshop or, you know, these things get very complex very quickly, and the static interface design solutions are just do not work. And people still try to shoehorn them in. So I think one of the biggest challenges that I think this could be interesting and useful for is to try to make better interface design for high functionality interfaces, which have to be more adaptive.
Yeah, I'd just like to tie this back to Simone's comment earlier and explainable AI. I think one of the problems with high functionality user interfaces is when they do something mysterious that the user doesn't understand, and it's very, very hard for them to figure out exactly why that just happened and to make the transition where they have the greater understanding. So figuring out a way of doing that, I think, is an exciting challenge for the future.
Maybe in addition to explainable AI, we need explainable UI.
Okay, yeah, since it's already lunchtime, I take one more question, okay?
Hi, Kashyap from Aalto University. Thanks for the great talk, I love this paper. I also work on adaptive interfaces, and I'll be presenting something about that makes the web adaptable later. My question's more about the cost of adaptation for users. I think one of the main things that makes adaptive interfaces annoying is that every adaptation has certain cost to it, and we still haven't fully understood how to model this cost to the users. So do you have some insights on how you tackle these challenges?
Why don't you start first?
I don't know why he's not speaking. He did the best work on the on this problem. So the question is, if we're used to something and then an adaptation occurs, we incur a cost because we have to deal with something new. So the question is, how do we do adaptation in such a way that we both leverage the kind of the optimally leverage the new situation and the existing knowledge that we've had? So I think your work was the most extensive and profound in this area. We tried to copy you a little bit by extending our cost function to also have an element that tied the new design to the previous design. So actually we did have a version of SAPL that, given what you knew and given a new situation, would try to generate user interface that would be as similar to the previous design as possible while also incorporating the new functionality and constraints.
Yeah, I mean, I think, so I did a fair amount of work on producing what we called personally consistent user interfaces, which I think is what you're talking about, right? That paper, I think, was at CHI 2006 or something. And I think there were several big challenges there. One was around, a big part of it was around, like, if there are really large changes between the two interfaces, how do you reconcile those? If there's different functionality across the two interfaces, how do you reconcile that? We came up with some heuristics that seemed to work, at least in the domain that we were in. But I think, I don't think there's a silver bullet answer. And I haven't seen any work on that since, I don't think. So go read that paper from 2006 and see if you agree with what we did, I guess.
I fear that we are about to end, so I just wanted to say that getting an award is the best way to ensure that you don't get to speak to students at the conference. So I just want to say that both Dan and I really enjoy speaking to students, and we are also not particularly outgoing. So if you think you've got something, a related interest, please talk to us.
Thank you to the panels, and also congratulate to the authors. So this concludes the session.